tattoo until his mom and dad got angry and they sent him to his room. After a while, Ray got lonely and he wanted a brand new friend. So he built a robot by the name of Pez, a legacy not very good. Now the year is 1994, and Ray is still inside his room. But he made a super transmitter so he can talk to me and you. They've created their fun world within their rooms for walls. So join us now as we take off to a place we love to call.
Hi everybody, Pez here, welcome to the show. Ray's off looking for his Star Trek album. He wanted to use it for this week's show again, but little does Ray know that Ernie and I, Pez D. Spencer, super genius, have done away with that tricky collectible for the last time. He'll just have to resort to plan B. here he comes.
Hey, Pez, have you seen my Star Trek album anywhere? I looked all through my closet and couldn't find it anywhere. I did find our Stretch Armstrong, although all the goo had drained out of him and formed a puddle of purple plastic.
Yes, I was wondering what that stuff was, but I haven't seen the Star Trek album. No, not me.
Jeez, and I wanted to do another story for everybody this week.
Did you check under the bed?
Well, yeah, but there's so much stuff crammed under there, I couldn't find a thing.
I guess we'll just have to go to Plan B.
Plan B? What'd you have in mind, Pez?
Plan B. Well, Plan B consists of Batman, the story of Gorilla City. It should be quite a chimp.
Holy underoos! Well, to the Batcave, Pez Wonder.
Welcome to the Wild
sleek
Kingdom.
Ebony aircraft wings its way eastward over the waters of the Atlantic. The pilot is the world's greatest detective.
Sherlock
the
Holmes.
The craft is the Batplane.
And the microwave is set
is
for
the
2 minutes.
Of darkest Africa.
Where is darkest Africa anyway?
Batman here, recording entry number 21A from my mission logbook. I am currently
well,
cruising
here,
at 123 miles per hour at an altitude of 57,000 feet. My estimated time of arrival over Africa's Kabanzi jungle will be approximately 25 minutes from now. As for the purpose of this flight to the largely unexplored Kabanzi Highlands, it all began only a few days ago.
I was in Bangkok,
when
Oriental
Commissioner
City.
Gordon asked a favor of me in his office.
Will you roof on my stretch marks?
John and Mary Tate, aren't they the man and wife team who won a Nobel Prize last year for their experiments with suspended animation?
And People Magazine's hottest couple.
And the fact that they'll be visiting Gotham City has been splashed all over the media. That's why I'd be grateful if you acted as the Tate's bodyguard while they're here.
Just
you're
like Kevin
worried
Costner.
About possible action from enemy agents.
Let's
Tex
just
Watson,
say there
Charles
are
Manson.
Several unfriendly foreign powers who would have no qualms about kidnapping the Tates to obtain their vital scientific research. I'd feel a lot better if I knew you'd never be far from their side.
Consider it done, Commissioner. Gordon was a cautious man.
And a good
And he was
lover.
Right. Every major power on Earth has been trying to crack the secret of suspended animation for years. And the Tate's award-winning work in time suspension biology seemed to put them closer to perfecting the process than anyone else.
Since Colonel Sanders...
All these thoughts ran through my mind as I met the famous couple that afternoon at Gotham Airport.
Hi, I'd like to tell you about the Reverend Moon, if I may.
Batman, this is indeed an honor. Told Mary and me to expect such an esteemed figure to offer himself as our guide to Gotham City.
Do you
swing? John and I have been in awe of you for years, Batman.
That
is
all
one feeling,
too.
Mrs. Tate, I assure you, is mutual. I consider it a privilege to be of service. I arranged to have the best suite at the Gotham Hilton
the
awaiting
honeymoon
the Tate,
suite.
And I made sure I was in the next room.
So
after
our love
a busy night of dinners and functions,
complete.
The Tates retired to their suite for a well-earned night's sleep. I, on the other hand, remained on guard in my room next door, using transcendental meditation to ease my mind into a relaxed level of consciousness. Relaxed, but ever alert. Much of the night drifted by peacefully, and then I heard it. My TM trance was suddenly interrupted by the sound of a breaking window.
A leather clown suit? No!
Is Batman wearing high heels?
I rushed into their suite. I was attacked by what I never had a chance to see. It was so dark.
Mr. Tate, I'm not into that kinky stuff.
But it was already too late. My mystery attacker had me from behind, and the crushing grip of a bear hug not even a grizzly could have matched.
Well, then it wouldn't be a bear hug,
could it? Within seconds, the vice-like grip had the best of me. I passed out.
Cold.
The next day, I couldn't turn on the TV or radio.
I woke up and my pants were undone.
Without hearing the same story.
And we here at WKGC can't help wondering if Batman's failure to rescue John and Mary Tate last night is a sign that it may finally be time for the cowled crusader to hang up his cowl.
Next to his
After all,
towel.
The famous Nobel Prize winning team is now missing, and
I'm
many
having
people
trouble
hope
getting
Batman
all this out.
But I was too busy to indulge bad publicity, as my faithful butler Alfred helped me conduct a series of exhaustive scientific tests in the crime lab of the Batcave.
See, Bobby, once we mix chemical A with chemical B, we form a rubber ball.
Battery of tests has narrowed down the classification of the pollen traces you scraped from your uniform after your skirmish last night.
You're right, Albert. I'm cross-checking the geographic tables now.
Here it is, my new triple-chambered bomb.
Arena.
Fire it up, Alfred.
And it is only distributed by plants in the Kabanzi jungle in Africa. That means whoever kidnapped the Tates last night came from that
Chicago.
Jungle.
Most intriguing. I'll fuel the Batplane for takeoff, sir.
Don't call me sir, sir.
Sir?
Yes, Alfred.
Sir?
About those unexplained traces of fur you found in the Tate suite.
Yes,
any conclusions?
I think I'll base them in a wine.
At least none that makes any kind of sense yet. Moments later, I was winging my way eastward, leaving
and
the Batcave and
myself.
Gotham City behind, with one slim clue to go on and no idea what lay waiting for me in Africa.
And no idea who the hell I was.
And speaking of Africa, I see the Kabanzi jungle is coming up directly ahead.
It's shaped
it's
like
time
a burrito.
For me to wrap up this report.
But before the Caped Crusader can end his log entry and switch off the tape.
Must switch off the tape.
Trouble. One of my turbo jets is backfired. The Batplane is nosediving out of control.
Uncontrollable flagellants.
Mayday, mayday. Controls don't respond properly. A crash landing imminent. Doing my best to avoid.
Finally, the smoldering and crippled Batplane comes to rest, leaving a torn and tattered figure slumped in the cockpit.
Amelia
a cowled
Earhart.
Figure that does not move or utter a sound. For many hours, the scene remains unchanged as life in the jungle proceeds in primitive ignorance of the damaged aircraft and its unmoving passenger. And then, as sunset filters through the tropical trees, a pair of rescuers appears, gently removing the limp, unconscious crime fighter from the shattered
gorillas
cockpit.
In the mist.
Did he sustain any permanent damage, do you think?
I would say negative. A mild concussion, several bruises and lacerations. His injuries don't seem to extend beyond that.
I found his head.
Into the city, our healing facility should completely restore his health.
Right, to the city then.
The two rescuers lumber away effortlessly, carrying the 180-pound Batman between them.
He's not
effortlessly,
heavy. He's my brother.
Because these rescuers are both gorillas.
Ask for them by name.
Hours pass. The Caped Crusader groggily moans and stirs. But it is not tropical vegetation and African wilds he opens his eyes to see. Instead, it is the antiseptic confines of an incredibly well-equipped, highly advanced laboratory.
Where am I?
In a highly advanced
laboratory.
Have
you ever heard of Gorilla City, Batman?
Well, I've been to Monkeyboro, and I've got a cousin from Lemurville.
Great Scott! John and Mary Tate!
Wow, how cool.
A super advanced city in the heart of darkest Africa, built and inhabited by apes.
A city where apes evolved from humans?
A city that is even invisible to the human eye, surrounded by a special force field only its gorilla inhabitants can see.
John and I had heard the legends like everyone else, but we never dreamed they were all true.
Batman always knew they were true, didn't you, Batman?
All eyes turn toward the source of that chilling, compelling voice of pure evil. The voice of Grodd.
Rush Limbaugh.
The most powerful and formidable of all the apes. Grodd, the super gorilla.
The super gorilla.
Tell the Tates how cleverly you worked your way in here.
Why don't you explain it, Grodd?
And I shall.
Of course, you know what Grodd spells backwards
is. A Batman, you see, no doubt use that renowned detective skill of his to pinpoint some clue my guerrilla agent must have left behind at the scene of your abduction, Mr. and Mrs. Tate. A clue that he could trace here to the Kabanzi jungle. Being as unusually well-informed as he is, Batman knew Gorilla City was purported to be in Kabanzi, although no human being had ever seen it. So what did Batman do? He deliberately crashed his plane and knocked himself out.
You know, he figuring must have seen a lot of old Batman City shows know the formula so well.
Batman, we appreciate all the trouble you went to.
What
you
a guy.
The experiments
really? Here's
we've been
some
conducting
homemade bread.
Are against our will.
Grodd has also kidnapped our daughter. Has threatened her safety.
See, it's
if we
our
don't
fifth time
exactly
being kidnapped,
says.
And it's really no big deal.
That sounds like your style, Grodd. Just what is it about the Tate suspended animation work you find so fascinating?
It goes well with mine.
You're about to find out for yourself, Batman.
Even before he can make a move to defend himself, Batman is seized by two gorilla guards and placed inside a plexiglass booth hooked up to an ominous pulsating machine.
And now
machine
for my Mongo magic imitation.
You see this little gadget I hold in my hand, Batman?
It's a floaty.
It's control
I'm going to cut your hair with a vacuum cleaner.
Next to you. The Tates call it a biological break. What it does is
I
slow down a person's metabolism and body functions to an absolute minimum to prepare him for suspended animation. It would even work on gorillas if the setting were correct.
But that's not
but
important
today,
right now.
You are our guinea pig, Batman.
He's sort of a
shall
guinea bat, isn't he?
Grodd presses the remote control device. The biological brake is activated, and a bolt of shimmering energy seems to flash through Batman's body.
Wow, the Cartoon Network!
The plexiglass booth is raised, and its prisoner staggers out.
Whoa, I'm energized.
Something wrong, Batman? You look a bit under the weather. Why don't you say something?
Something.
Anything. What's happening? To me.
What's
very simple, Batman. You have become a living example of slow motion. You now
you're
walk,
a super
talk,
sloth.
React, even think 10 times slower than a normal man. The world's greatest detective has been rendered totally useless. Now let's see how good you are at defending yourself.
Oh, stop.
Don't
that.
Do that.
Stop it, Grodd. You're tossing him around like he was a rag doll.
Please,
he's treating him like a piece of luggage.
Batman does not deserve such an easy death. I am through toying with him for now. What I have in mind for his demise will be far more excruciating.
At once, John and Mary rush to the fallen Cape Crusader's side, only to discover...
Oh,
no! A woman!
He's dead, Grodd. I hope you're satisfied now.
Get away from there. Does Batman think he can fool me as easily as a human?
The grieving takes back away as an angry Grodd kneels beside Batman's limp body, placing the remote control device on the floor of the booth.
It's a trick.
Or treat.
Batman should have recovered by now. The slowdown effect is temporary.
Grodd places his massive head over Batman's chest, listening for a heartbeat that isn't there. But he doesn't notice Batman's hand moving slowly toward the remote control device. His fingers find the activator button.
My
they
activator!
Push it.
Wow, Comedy Central.
In a bolt of shimmery energy this time, while the masked manhunter unexpectedly springs to his feet in time to avoid the pulsating beam.
Batman, you're alive!
I knew he couldn't be dead. I just knew it.
She must
and
have read the script.
Grodd, let's see how you like a dose of your own slow medicine. It's not so easy, Batman.
Big Jim Slade, former quarterback for the Kansas City Chiefs.
Surprise, Batman. You forget, I'm a super gorilla. The biological break takes a lot longer to affect me. Long enough for me to crush the life out of you first.
Desperately, every muscle in his superbly conditioned body being ripped apart in tortured agony, Batman tries to pry himself loose from the bone-crushing grip of the killer gorilla.
That's it, Batman. Keep fighting it.
Sounds like
the
Batman's puking.
The tighter my grip becomes. Until I finished squeezing the very
it keeps light going and going.
Finally, the biological break finally took effect. Grodd's not even moving.
But neither is Batman.
Is he?
And then a weak but reassuring voice puts the Tate's fears to rest.
Mommy.
I'll be all right. As soon as I slip through Grodd's arms, his reactions are too slow to stop me now.
Boy, and as an exhausted but breathing Batman extricates himself from what almost became a horrible crushing death.
How in the world did you fool Grodd, Batman? When he listened for your heart,
I was once
he
a super thespian.
Because I was practicing an extremely difficult form of yoga that allowed a full minute between heartbeats.
Yoga.
Incredible.
But what do we do now, Batman? Grodd's gorilla henchmen are all around us.
They're harmless without their leader.
But we'll shoot
it
them anyway.
It was brainwaves from Grodd's super mind that was dominating the other apes, forcing them to obey his commands. Normally, the citizens of Gorilla City are among the friendliest on Earth.
But when my plane crashed and burned down their village, things changed.
And true to Batman's words, the super-advanced gorillas show John and Mary Tate nothing but the finest VIP treatment.
Thank you for returning our daughter to us so promptly, Solovar.
Yes, you and the other gorillas have truly been splendid hosts these past few days.
It's the least we could do, Mr.
Waddy
Tate,
McDowell.
After what Grodd put your family through. But now that he's in our maximum security pen,
we're going to fling our crap at him
and race for many years to come.
And now for your complimentary flea picking.
Does the jet craft we furnished meet your approval?
Indeed it does, Solovar. And it's fueled and ready to go. Your daughter is already on board waiting to take off, Mr. Tate.
Very well, then. It's time to say our farewells.
Toodaloo. See you later, alligator.
After all, crocodile.
Moments till then, later, penguin.
A gorilla jet craft soars into the jungle sky.
Not now,
as
brown
Batman
cow.
Pilots the Tate family home.
Okey-dokey, artichoke.
Gorilla city behind them once again.
Hasta manana, iguana.
In the wilds of darkest Africa.
I can't see so good.
Wow, you know, actually, that was a pretty good story, Pez. I kind of enjoyed it. I mean, hell, it was a lot better than last week's episode, at least.
Yes, very fine, very educational. I found it very moving.
Well, educational I don't know about, but at least it was pretty good. But you know, for all of Batman's trouble, he never used his utility belt. I mean, no, not a single batarang, no bat smoke, no bat grappling hook, no bat shark repellent.
No bat gorilla repellent. I wonder if Batman's utility belt was as cool as Richie Rich's watch. I mean, it had everything.
Well, yeah, Richard had some pretty cool stuff. But I wonder what Batman had in his utility belt that we never got to see.
Like the bat toenail clipper.
Or bat laxative.
The bat lint remover.
How about the bat candle snuffer?
The bat mini Spanish dictionary.
You know, I bet he actually had one of those. How about bat nasal spray?
The bat bunion remover.
Or the ever useful bat protractor.
The bat handy dandy slicer dicer and portable pool stick.
The always funny bat fake doggy do.
The bat bubblegum remover for getting that gum from the bottom of your shoe.
Or the bat blowtorch.
Ah. Ray, I think you really had one of those.
Well, hey, that's going to do it for this week's episode of Planet Goldar. Be sure and tune in next Thursday morning at 9 o'clock on Caffeine and Go-Go as we broadcast to you again. Hey, if you're a big fan of Planet Goldar and visit there frequently, we'd like to know about it. So you can, A, call the station at 644-1VFS between now and 10 o'clock, as we'd love to hear questions, comments, or suggestions. And also, if you'd like to draw pictures of Pez D. Spencer and what you think he looks like, you can mail them to, write this down, Planet Goldar at 262 Ausley Road, that's A-U-S-L-E-Y, Tallahassee, Florida, 32304. Bye now.